Respected ulama, my respected elders, my brothers and my little ones, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. After praising the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending salutations on Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I begin as always by first thanking you, my host, for giving me this opportunity to convey the message of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I pray to the Almighty Allah that Allah accepts these efforts of yours in listening to this message, as I pray to the Almighty Allah that Allah accepts these efforts of mine in trying to deliver the message of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as it was revealed on our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in its true and pure form over 1400 years ago. My young friends, the blessed month of Zilhijjah has begun. Eid al-Adha is around the corner. Very soon, in every masjid, in every corner of the globe, from America to South Africa, Venezuela to Beijing in China, you will hear the echoes of the takbir. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Walillahi alhamd. There is not a single thing within this universe that does not acknowledge the greatness of Allah. There is not a single thing within this universe that doesn't praise Allah, that doesn't glorify Allah. وَإِن مِّن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا يُصَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِهِ. From the fish in the ocean, to the birds in the sky, from the trees to the storms, every single thing within this universe glorifies Allah, praises Allah, acknowledges the greatness of Allah. And very soon you will hear the believers in every corner of the globe raising their voices with the takbir. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest. La ilaha illallah. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. There is no God worthy of worship but Allah. Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest. Walillahi alhamd. And all praises are for Allah. My young friends, at this moment in time, the Muslims from every corner of the globe are descending upon Makkatul Mukarramah. On the 8th of Zilhijjah, they will proceed to Mina. They will spend the day and night there following the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On the 9th of Zilhijjah, they will proceed to the plains of Arafat. And they will spend the entire day worshipping Allah, standing on the plains with their hands raised high, tears flowing from their eyes, begging for Allah's mercy, begging Allah and asking Allah to purify them and to allow them to return just like the day their mother gave them birth, free and pure from sin. And then my young friends, they will proceed to Muzdalifah. And from Muzdalifah, they will make their way to Mina. They will pelt the shaitan. And thereafter make their way to Makkatul Mukarramah. And perform Tawaful Ziyarah. And then they will return to carry on the rituals of Hajj in Mina. And then they will return again to Makkatul Mukarramah. They will perform the farewell Tawaf. And thereafter, they will travel hundreds and hundreds of kilometers to Madinatul Munawwara to express their love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My young friends, when I think of the Hajj, the name of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam comes to mind. Was he not the Nabi to whom Allah ordered, وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالٌ وَعَلَىٰ كُلِّ ضَامِرٍ يَأْتِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ فَجٍّ عَمِيقٍ. O Ibrahim, make the call. Invite people to my house in Makkatul Mukarramah. O Ibrahim, tell them about the Hajj. Tell them to come Makkah and perform the Hajj. Tell them about Umrah. Tell them to perform the Umrah. Tell them to perform Tawaf around my blessed house. Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam asked Allah, O Allah, indeed, I will carry out your command. Oh Allah, but I'm here in Makkah. There's no one that lives in Makkah. Makkah is a barren desert. People live hundreds and hundreds of miles away. Thousands of thousands of miles away. In different corners of the globe. Oh Allah, I will make the call. But these people will not be able to hear my call. Oh Allah, who will convey the sound of my voice to these masses? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds, O Ibrahim, minkal adhan wa alayya al-balagh. Your job is to convey, your job is to make the call. My job and responsibility is to convey the sound of your voice to the masses, wherever they may be. Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, he climbs Mount Abi Qubais, and then he faces the north, and then he faces the south, and then he faces the east, and then he faces the west. Every time he makes the call, Ya ayyuhan nas, inna rabbakum kad bana baytan fuhujju. Ya ayyuhan nas, inna rabbakum kad bana baytan fuhujju. Ya ayyuhan nas, inna rabbakum kad bana baytan fuhujju. O people, your Lord has made himself a house in Makkah wa Karramah. Come and visit the house of your Lord. Come and perform the Hajj. Come and perform the Umrah. Come and perform the Tawaf. Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, when he made this call, not only did Allah convey the sound of his voice to all those that were living on the dunya, wherever it may be, even though they were living thousands and thousands of miles away from the sacred house and the blessed city of Makkah al-Mukarramah, not did only Allah convey the sound of his voice to every single person on the earth, Allah conveyed the sound of his voice to all those that were in the heaven. Allah conveyed the sound of his voice to those that were not even born, to those that didn't even come, and those that were to come right till the day of judgment. Allah conveyed the sound of his voice to every single one. And when they heard the call and cry of Ibrahim, they began to respond one after the other. Labbaik Allahumma labbaik. Labbaik Allahumma labbaik. Oh Allah, I am here. Oh Allah, I am here. Oh Allah, I am here. Our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, today people are performing Hajj according to how many times they responded to the call and cry of Ibrahim. Those that responded once are performing the Hajj once. Those that responded five times will perform the Hajj five times. And those that responded 10 times will perform the Hajj 10 times. So when I think of the Hajj, the name of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam comes to mind. My young friends, when I think of the Holy Kaaba in Makkah al-Mukarramah, the name of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam comes to mind. Look at the simplicity of the design. You will not find a design more simple than this. But in spite of the simplicity of the design, look at the beauty of the house of Allah. I swear by Allah, you can look at the Holy Kaaba and you can keep on looking. You can look by day. You can look by night. Week in, week out. I swear by Allah, no matter how many times you look, a true believer, his thirst will never be quenched, and his hunger will never be satisfied, and he will keep on looking again and again and again. When I think of the house of Allah, the name of Ibrahim comes to mind. Was it not this Nabi that received the honor to build the house of Allah? وَإِذْ يَرْفَوْ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَائِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ وَإِسْمَعِيلِ رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنْ إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. Was he not the one that raised the foundations of the house? Was he not the one that built this house with his son, Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam? And when he finished building this house, he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا. Oh Allah, accept this humble effort of ours. إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. You are the all-hearer. You are the all-knower. رَبَّنَا وَجْعَلْنَا مُسْلِمَيْنِ لَكْ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِنَا أُمَّةً مُسْلِمَةً. Oh Allah, make us obedient. Oh Allah, make us Muslim. Make us obedient. Oh Allah, make us subservient. Oh Allah, give us the tawfiq to worship you as you should be worshipped. Oh Allah, take out from my progeny an ummah that will be Muslim. An ummah that will be obedient to you. An ummah that will be subservient to you. An ummah that will worship you by day and by night. Wa arina manasikana. Oh Allah, you've asked us to make the call. Oh Allah, tell us how to perform the manasik. Tell us how to perform the hajj. وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. When I look at the house of Allah, the name of Ibrahim comes to mind. When I think and look at the maqami Ibrahim in its gold casket, thousands and thousands of people are desperate and die to read namaz behind the maqami Ibrahim. The name of Ibrahim comes to mind. Fihi ayatun bayyinat maqamu Ibrahim wa man dakhalahu kana amina. Was this not the blessed stone upon which Sayyidina Ibrahim would stand, and he would arc like a lift, and he would make the house of Allah with his son Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam. My young friends, when I look at the Ma'i Zamzam, the well of Zamzam, the name of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam comes to mind. How this well has been quenching the thirst of millions and millions of people for thousands and thousands of years, and it will continue to quench the thirst of millions and millions of people right till the day of judgment. When I think of the well of Zamzam, the name of Ibrahim comes to mind. When I think of the mountain Safa and Marwa, and how thousands of people perform sahih by day and by night between these mountains, and inshallah will continue to do so right till the day of judgment, the name of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam comes to mind. My young friends, when I think of the holy city of Makkah, and how this holy city of Makkah, once upon a time in a barren desert, today has become the capital of the Muslim world, thousands and thousands from every corner of the globe head towards Makkah, flock towards Makkah every single day of the year, 365 days in a year, and have been doing this for thousands and thousands of years, and will continue to do this for thousands and thousands of years. The name of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam comes to mind. My young friend, when I see the shops of Makkah laden with fruit, all types of fruit you will find in these shops. The fruits of winter, you will find them in summer. The fruits of summer, you will find them in winter. Fruit from every corner of the globe. And this has been happening, not just today or yesterday, for hundreds and hundreds of years. The name of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam comes to mind. Was he not that Nabi that raised his hands and made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? وَرْزُقْ أَهْلَهُ مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ مَنْ آمَنَ مِنْهُمْ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. O Allah, give the inhabitants of Makkah thamarat. Give them fruits. O Allah, give them the end result of everything. This is why, my young friend, when you go to Makkah, not only will you find fruits, thamarat, the end result of everything, you will find in Makkah al-Mukarramah. So when I think of this, the name of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam comes to mind. When I see women roaming around in late hours of the night in Makkah al-Mukarramah, at 1 o'clock at night, at 2 o'clock at night, with hundreds and hundreds of riyals in their pockets, never mind rape, not one single human being even raises an eye with an evil intention towards them. The name of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam comes to mind. Was he not that Nabi that made this dua? وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّ اجْعَلْ هَذَا الْبَلَدَ آمِنًا. O Allah, make this city a city of peace, a city of aman. My young friends, when I think of this, the name of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam comes to mind. When I think of our beloved Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the name of Ibrahim comes to mind. Was he not the Nabi that made this dua? رَبَّنَا وَبْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. رَبَّنَا وَبْعَثْ. O Allah, send from amongst them a messenger from amongst them. O Allah, send Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yatru alayhim ayatika. Muhammad will recite your verses upon them. Wa yu'allimuhum al-kitaba wal hikmah. He will teach them the book. He will teach them hikmah. Wa yuzakkihim. O Allah, he will purify them. Innaka antal azizul hakim. O Allah, you are the Almighty and you are the All Wise. My young friends, when I see the tears flowing from the eyes of those that cannot go for Hajj, saying farewell to the Hajjis, when I see the when I see the blind performing the Hajj, when I see the old and weak that can barely walk, traveling thousands of miles to Makkah al-Mukarramah from every corner of the globe, the name of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam comes to mind. Was he not the one that made the dua? فَاجْعَلْ أَفْئِدَةً مِنَ النَّاسِ تَهْوِي إِلَيْهِمْ O Allah, fill the hearts of some from amongst men with love towards them. This is why you find, my young friends, even though the Hajj is a very long and tiring journey, no matter how many times a Haji experiences difficulty, he wants to go again and again and again. And whenever he gets the opportunity, irrespective of the difficulties, he makes his way to Makkah al-Mukarramah and he performs the Hajj. My young friends, when I think of ourselves, the name of Ibrahim comes to mind. Was he not the Nabi who was sammakum al-Muslimin, that gave us our name and that gave us our identity? The name of Ibrahim will keep on coming to mind, my young friends. Everything about this great Nabi was phenomenal. Everything about this Nabi was phenomenal. My young friend, his level of Iman was phenomenal. His belief in Allah was phenomenal. His tawakkul, relying upon Allah, was phenomenal. My young friends, his sacrifices are beyond comprehension. My young friends, his character was amazing. His every single thing about him was phenomenal. He was, as the Quran describes, Inna Ibrahim kana ummatan qanitan lillahi hanifa wa lam yakun min al-mushrikeen. My young friends, who can forget when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the call, when Allah gave him the command, without any hesitation whatsoever, without stopping and thinking for a few minutes, without pondering, without deliberating, without consulting anyone, when Allah ordered him to sacrifice his son, Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam, without hesitation, Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam offered his child in sacrifice for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My young friends, you and I will never ever be able to comprehend the true nature of this sacrifice. We will never be able to comprehend the true nature of this sacrifice. We cannot even comprehend 1%. 1%. We can't even visualize in our minds just 1% of this sacrifice that Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam made. And the reason I am saying, my young friends, that we will never be able to truly comprehend this sacrifice that Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam made is because, my young friends, you and I are the fortunate ones. You and I are the fortunate ones. Look at how blessed we are. Look at how many blessings Allah has showered us with. Majority of us that live in this country, their origins are Pakistan, Hindustan, Afghanistan, Bangladesh, and countries like this. Majority of us were farmers by background. We were so poor that we didn't even know what white flour looked like. Our forefathers used to eat bread made out of barley. Our mothers used to borrow clothes just on the day of their wedding when they used to become wives. This was our origin. Look at where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from where Allah brought us, and look at where Allah took us. Look at our condition a few years ago. Look at our condition today. How many blessings Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has showered us with. My young friend, now you wake up in the morning like a king. In the afternoon you're like a king. In the evening like you're a king. When you sit down for breakfast, I ask you, my young friend, how many things are at your disposal? Where people at this moment in time are dying. They do not know where their next morsel will come from. I swear by Allah, majority of us, when we wake up in the morning, look at how many things are at our disposal. If you want to eat cereal, how many cereals will you find inside your house? From your cornflakes, to your Weetabixes, to your Rice Krispies. If you want to have biscuits for breakfast, how many biscuits do you have at your disposal? You have cookies, you have sports biscuits, you have this, custard creams, you have this. If you want a hot drink, then how many different drinks are at your disposal? From tea to coffee to what you call it, cappuccinos. You want a cold drink to your disposal, a cold drink. How many cold drinks are at your disposal? This is just breakfast. Allah has showered us with blessings. And Allah continues to do so. In spite of the fact that many of us disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by day and by night, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showers us and continues to do so. Without us ever asking, without us ever begging. Look at the children that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. يَهَبُ لَمَنْ يَشَاءُ إِنَاثًا وَيَهَبُ لَمَنْ يَشَاءُ الذُّكُورُ أَوْ يُزَوِّجُهُمْ ذُكْرَانًا وَإِنَاثًا. To some, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given a boy. To some, Allah has given a girl. To some, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed and given both. Blessing upon blessing upon blessings. My young friends, we need to realize the value of these blessings. Because I swear by Allah, the day Allah takes away this blessing, this is the day you will realize the value of this blessing, and it will be too late. We need to realize the value of these blessings. You're sitting here at this moment in time in front of me. It has never ever crossed your mind that you can ever become blind. But just imagine hypothetically, you're sitting here, you're looking at me, I'm looking at you. I'm delivering this reminder, you're listening to this reminder. This thought has never ever crossed your mind that you can lose this eyesight, you can lose this blessing and ni'mat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. Can you imagine here and now, as you're looking at me, all of a sudden your vision becomes blurred. So you begin to rub your eyes. And then within seconds, all of a sudden, you realize there's darkness. You can see nothing. So now you're in doubt. Okay, is this something that's temporary? Is my eyesight going to return? So you look towards your right, but your eyesight is not returning. You begin to rub your eyes more and more and more. Now fear and gham start entering your heart. You look towards the left, and again, you can't see anything. Now you begin to sweat. You're sitting there in this gathering. You're not in a position of telling anyone, but you're afraid like you've never been in your entire life. And now you begin to sweat like you've never sweated in your entire life. I swear by Allah, never mind making it home into your cozy homes, you will not be able to leave this gathering. Within a zillionth of a second, the earth, in spite of its vastness, has become tight on you. Within a zillionth of a second, from a totally independent person, you become a totally dependent person. And I swear by Allah, if you possess millions and millions of dollars, and eyesight was sold on the market, I would not hesitate to say, you would spend those dollars just to buy your eyesight again. This is the value of one blessing. Look at how many blessings Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showered us with. We have no value for it. When was the last time you ever had to raise your hand and beg Allah and ask Him, Oh Allah, I beg you, give me a few more morsels so I can see the light of the next day. When is it that you ever raise your hand to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for something as little as a meal? Never. We wrong Him, but still Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides. Where are we going to understand the sacrifice of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam? When Allah has pampered us and looked after us. Only those to whom Allah has not given a child, or to those who Allah gave a child, but He gave them this child after years and years of begging, after crying, after prostrating, after bowing. Only these people can comprehend the sacrifice of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. And even these people, my young friends, they cannot comprehend the true nature of this sacrifice. They can only get a rough idea of this sacrifice. Because even though Allah may have given them a child, after 10 years of trying, 15 years of trying, 20 years of trying, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not take their child from them. Allah did not ask them to offer their child in sacrifice. This is why I say, my young friends, they will get a rough idea. To some degree, they'll be able to comprehend the sacrifice of Ibrahim. They will not be able to comprehend the true nature of the sacrifice. Let me explain, my young friends. I'm sure that you're all aware. Our father, Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, was married to our mother, Hazrat Sarah. Now, what tends to happen when you get married? If you look at the general trend, in general, whenever somebody gets married, in general, you see, after a year, Allah blesses them with a child, be it a girl, be it a boy. If it's not within the first year, Allah blesses them within the second year. If it's not within the second year, in general, third or fourth year, within a short time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses them with a child. Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam is married to our mother Hazrat Sarah. 1 year of marriage passes and there is no child, and the Khalil of Allah turns to Allah and begs Allah, Rabbi habli min as-salihin. Oh Allah, I beg you, give me a pious son. Give me a righteous son. 2 years of marriage pass and there is no child. And Sayyidina Ibrahim a.s. makes this dua, رَبِّ حَبْلِ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. Oh Allah, give me a pious son. Give me a righteous son. 5 years of marriage passed, and there is still no child. And Ibrahim is still making dua, رَبِّ حَبْلِ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. 10 years of marriage passed, and there is still no child. And Ibrahim is still making the dua, رَبِّ حَبْلِ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. 15 years of marriage passed. 20 years of marriage passed. 25 years of marriage passed. 30 years of marriage passed. The years are passing by. There is no child. Allah is not responding. Allah is not answering the dua of Sayyidina Ibrahim. But Ibrahim alayhi salam keeps on bowing. Ibrahim alayhi salam keeps on crying. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam keeps on asking. He keeps on making dua. Rabbi habli min as-salihin. As every day passes, Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam is becoming older. As every day passes, Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam is becoming weaker. Slowly but surely, the color of his hair are changing. Our mother Sarah has now got to an age in which women normally do not give birth. The aql and the intellect says that the future is getting bleaker and bleaker for Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. He's becoming weak. His wife has passed that age in which women normally give birth. The aql is saying that future is getting bleaker and bleaker. But look at the level of iman of the Khalil of Allah. When it came to Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, there was no such thing as La taqnatu min rahmatillah. There was no such thing as despairing. There was no such thing as becoming mayus of the mercy of Allah. Why should Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam despair? Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam knew, one that loses hope in the mercy of Allah, this individual is a loser in the dunya, and this individual is a loser in the akhirah. Why should he lose hope in the mercy of Allah? Ibrahim was making dua to the Allah that is the Lord of the heavens and the earth. The Allah that is the Lord of the Arsh and Kursi. The Allah that is the Lord of the entire universe. The Allah that is the Al-Qadir, that has the power to do as He pleases, whenever He pleases. He possesses the power of kun fayakun. Innama amruhu idha arada shay'an an yaqula lahu kun fayakun. Whenever Allah desires anything, or Allah says be, and when Allah says kun, within a zillionth of a second, fayakun, that thing comes into wujud, that thing comes into existence. This was the Allah that the Khalil of Allah was making dua to. He was making dua to the Allah that can make the impossible possible. Aql and the intellect says, a child cannot be born without a mother and father. My young friends, Ibrahim was making dua to the Allah that had already created as Isa alayhi salatu wasalam from a mother without a father. The aql says, the intellect says, a child cannot be born without a mother and father. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was making dua to the Allah that had already created as Hawa alayhi salam from a male without the aid of a female. The aql and the intellect says, and science says, that a child cannot be born without a mother and father. Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was making dua to the Allah that has already created as Adam alayhi salatu wasalam without a male and without a female, without a husband and wife. Allah had already created as Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. So why should Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam lose hope in the mercy of Allah? Why should he lose hope in Allah? Ibrahim was making dua to the Allah that would provide Hazrat Maryam alayhi. He would provide her the fruits of winter in summer and the fruits of summer in winter. كلما دخل عليها زكريا المحراب وجد عندها رزقا قالت يا مريم أن لك هذا. Every time Hazrat Zakaria would enter the mihrab, he would open the keys to the door of Hazrat Maryam alayhi salam, and he would enter. He would be shocked that this little girl sitting there, and she's got all types of fruits in front of her, pomegranates and peaches and bananas and apples and mangoes. She has the fruits of winter in summer, and she has the fruits of summer in winter. Sayyidina Zakaria alayhi salatu wasalam bewildered that he is the only one with the key. Nobody has access to this room other than him. He would ask her, or Maryam, where's this fruit come from? Nobody can enter. I'm the only one that possesses the key. And she would say, قالت هو من عند الله. This is come from Allah. إن الله يرزق من يشاء بغير حساب. Allah provides for whoever He likes without asbab. This is the Allah that Ibrahim Khalilullah was making dua to. He was making dua to the Allah that heard the cry of Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam. Where was Hazrat Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam when he made the cry? Sayyidina Yusuf, Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam was in the stomach of a whale. So there was the darkness of the stomach. And then this whale was inside the sea. There was the darkness of the sea. He was so close to the seabed that Sayyidina Yunus alayhi salam could actually hear the pebbles glorifying Allah, praising Allah. This is when Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam called out, La ilaha illa anta subhanak. There is no God worthy of worship but you, Allah. Wallah, you are pure from all defects. Inni kuntu min al-zalimeen. Oh Allah, verily I was from amongst the zalimeen. I was from amongst the wrongdoers. Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam called to Allah. And Allah responded to the call and cry of Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam and delivered him from this difficulty. This was the Allah that Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was making dua to. He was making dua to the Allah that answered the prayer of Hazrat Zakaria alayhi salam when he made this dua. Inni wahana al-azmu minni washta'ala ar-ra'su shayba walam akun bidu'aika rabbi shakiya. Oh Allah, look at me. Oh Allah, my bones are crackling. Oh Allah, they become weak. Oh Allah, look at my hair. They're turning grey. Oh, look at my wife. Oh Allah, she's barren. She can't give birth. Oh Allah, she passed the age in which women give birth. Fahabli min ladunka waliya. But Allah, you make the impossible possible. Oh Allah, you are the Qadir. Oh Allah, you possess the power of kun fayakun. Oh Allah, when you say be, it will be. He made dua to Allah. And Allah responded by giving him Hazrat Yahya alayhi salam. This was the Allah that Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was making dua to. So why should Ibrahim become despair of the mercy of Allah and the rahmat of Allah? And this is the message, my young friends, I like to share with all those. All those to whom Allah has not yet given a child. Never lose hope in the mercy of Allah. There is only one being that can help you. There is only one being that can give you what you want. There is only one being that can respond to your cry and your dua. And that being is Allah. Keep on making dua. Keep on crying before Allah. Keep on bowing down and prostrating. Get up in the latter hours of the night and cry before Allah and make the dua. رَبَّنَا هَبْلَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ. Oh Allah, I beg you, give me wife. Oh Allah, give me offspring that will become a source of comfort and joy and happiness and contentment for me. Keep on making this dua day in, day out, night in, night out, irrespective of how long it takes. When and if Allah thinks the best thing for you is this child, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inshaAllah will respond to your dua and Allah will give you this child. Allah will give you this child. Ibrahim is making this dua. Years and years are passing. Years and years are passing. Then one day, my young friend, according to some mufassirin, at the age of 86, the dua of Ibrahim was accepted. At the age of 86, the dua of Ibrahim was accepted. And who was Ibrahim? The Khalil of Allah. The Khalil of Allah, the near and dear friend of Allah. Allah befriended him. Allah befriended him. This was the Khalil of Allah, and his dua has been accepted at the age of 86. You know, you and I, we think we're God's gift. We raise our hand once. Our minds all over. We never worship Allah. We can barely offer our salah. We raise our hands once. And we expect Allah to deliver. Soon as we click, we expect Allah to deliver. And when we see that our prayer has zahiran not been accepted, we begin to raise objections on Allah. Okay, what's the point of asking when He doesn't deliver? And here you have the Ibrahim, the Khalil of Allah, begging Allah by day, begging Allah by night. And Allah heard and Allah responded to his cry at the age of 86. My young friends, not a single dua goes unanswered. Not a single dua goes unanswered, not a single dua. There may be delay in the dua being answered. And you know how I see it? How I see it is that, you know what? You must be doing something right. Allah's loving your action. He loves the way you're raising your hands. He loves the way you're begging. He loves the way you're turning to Him. And Allah just wants to look at that again and again and again. This is why there's a delay in your prayer being answered. Because Allah likes, you know, the abdiyat inside you. The abdiyat, you know, being a servant of Allah. You're actually showing Allah your abdiyat. You're showing Allah your weakness. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves most of all. When this insan shows his weakness and acknowledges Allah's greatness, there's nothing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves more than this. This is why when you're in prostration, a person is closest to Allah. Why? Because he, again, you're humbling yourself before Allah. You're showing your weakness to Allah. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. When the slave of Allah is playing the part of being a slave, and allowing the master to play the part of the master, there is nothing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves more than this. Not a single prayer goes unanswered, my young friend. Sometimes Allah will give you what you ask for, there and then. Sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you something similar. And sometimes there's an evil coming towards you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in place of that dua that you made, Allah wards off that evil. He stops it from reaching you. And if Allah doesn't do this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps the reward stored for you in the akhirah. So much so, that when you come and meet Allah on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you zillions and zillions of reward. And you can't recall. You can't remember that you've deserved this, you've done any deed to receive this reward. And you'll ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where's all this come from? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remind you in the dunya, you made this dua, I didn't give you anything in return for it in dunya. I kept the ajr here stored with me here. This is the ajr for that dua. And when you see that reward, you'll say, you'll desire, only if in dunya, not one of my du'as were accepted, so today I would receive so much reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No du'a goes unanswered. Get into the habit of making this connection with Allah. Raising your hands and making du'a. You know, we live in an era where people haven't got time to offer their salah, never mind making du'a. And dua is such a thing that you don't have to just sit down after your farz namaz or your sunnahs or your nawaf and make dua. Wherever you are, you can sit in your car and you can converse with Allah. It's not necessary to raise your hands. I mean, even though it's good to raise your hands, because again, you're asking. And Allah loves it. You know, this is a way of asking, you're begging, and Allah loves it to be begged. But you don't have to raise your hands. You can converse with Allah just sitting in your car on the way to work. Get into the habit of speaking to Him. Get into the habit of asking Him for every single thing. The more you ask, the more Allah loves. And the more Allah will give. And when Allah gives, your iman will become stronger and stronger in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So get into the habit of making this dua. This is another lesson that we can take. So at the age of 86, Ibrahim alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him a child. And how did this take place? Imam Bukhari narrates in his Sahih, because Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam is walking in the land of Egypt. And he says to our mother Sarah, that in this land there's a zalim king. And this king, whenever he sees a beautiful young woman, he rapes her. And if this woman is accompanied by a husband, he kills the husband. And if she's accompanied by any other person, any other mahram, then he doesn't kill him. So he said to his wife, our mother Sarah, please tell him that you are my sister in deen. There is no believer on the face of this earth, in this land, other than you and I. Tell him that you are my sister, referring to sister in deen. What happens? The king approaches her. And as he approaches her, she stands before the Almighty Allah in prayer. This is the teaching of our deen. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu ista'inu بالصبر والصلاة. You know, you're always looking after Moli Sahab. You know, when you're in difficulty, you're looking for Moli Sahab, Imam Sahab, Sheikh Sahab. You're looking for some guy that does ruqya to help you in this difficulty. Look at what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. يَا أَيُّوَ الَّذِينَ آمُنُوا اسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. Seek Allah's help. You want Allah's help? Then Allah is saying, be patient. Sabr. Sabr, you and I, as you and I know it, we only know sabr alil masaib. Okay, when you're on a difficulty, then you be tolerant. Without doubt, that is a form of sabr. But the muhaddithin write, there are three types of sabr. Sabr alil masaib, just like I've described. Sabr ala ta'a, The nafs doesn't like to bow down. The nafs doesn't like to get up for Fajr Salah. The nafs doesn't like to do wudu. The nafs doesn't like to give charity. The nafs doesn't like to do ta'at. It doesn't like to do good deed. So you make sabr. Even though the nafs doesn't like it, you're persistent. You stay firm. You make sabr and you do that good. This is sabr ala ta'ah. Sabr anil ma'siyah. The nafs likes to commit sin. It rushes towards sin. Saturday night, it wants to go out for a rave, for a party. It likes committing sin. So you make sabr here also. You stop the nafs from committing this sin. You eat your desire. This is sabr anil ma'siyah. All three forms of sabr. The more sabr you do, the more help you will receive from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at the same time, was-salah. Turn to Allah. You're turning to the imam. You're looking for an amil that will look for ruqya. You're looking for X, Y, and Z. But the only being that can help, you're not turning to him. Which is the only being that can help and never fail if he helps? The only being that can help is Allah. We never turn to him. The Nabi of Allah. Whenever he would experience difficulty, the first thing Rasulullah would do would stand before the Almighty Allah and pray. Look at in Badr 313. Everyone's more or less sleeping. The entire night Rasulullah stayed awake begging for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy. When the wind would blow, again Rasulullah afraid would turn. When there was an eclipse, what did Rasulullah do? Again, Rasulullah would turn to Salah. It brings about the help of Allah. So she stood in Salah. When she finished and in Salah, she made dua. Allahumma in kunta ta'alam, anni amantu bik wa bi rasulik, wa ahsandu farji illa ala zawji, fala tusallit ali al-kafir. Wallah, you know I believe in you. Wallah, you know I believe in your Rasul Ibrahim alayhi salam. Wallah, you know I've preserved myself all these years only for my husband. I beg you, do not set this kafir upon me. She makes the dua. After salah, he advances towards her with evil intention and his hands become paralyzed. He says to her, make dua to your God that he makes my hand better and I will let you be. She makes dua to Allah, but he doesn't honor his word. Again, he advances towards her. And again, she makes the dua. Allahumma inni amantu bik wa bi rasulik. وَأَحْسَنْتُ فَرْجِي إِلَّا عَلَىٰ زَوْجِي فَلَا تُصَلِّتْ عَلِيَ الْكَافِرِ. Wallah, I believe in you. Wallah, you know I believe in your messenger. Wallah, I've preserved all my life. I beg you, do not disgrace me and dishonor me. Wallah, I beg you, do not set this kafir upon me. And again, when he advances towards her with evil intention, and again, for the second time, his hand becomes paralyzed. Again, he says, make dua to your Allah that he makes me better and I assure you I will let you go. But for the second time she makes dua and for the second time he goes against his word. The same thing happens for the third time. But on this third occasion he honors his word and he lets her be. And he says to his people, let her go. She's not a human being. This woman is a jinniya. Let her be, let her go free. And in turn he gives her a gift in the form of our mother Hazrat Hajar. He gives her a gift in the form of our mother Hazrat Hajar. And our mother Hazrat Sarah gives in turn Hajar to our father Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, saying, maybe, O Ibrahim, Allah will give you a child through her. She gives her as a gift. Look at the obedience, look at the love that our mother had for Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam. This is not easy for any woman to do. You know, when you go from here, ask your wife. Yeah. Look at the response that she will give you. No woman is prepared to share her husband with another woman. No woman is. Look at the level of iman. Look at how much love she has for Ibrahim. Go Ibrahim, take her. Maybe Allah will give you a child through her. Our mother, Hazrat Hajar, is now expecting. And the dua Ibrahim has been answered at the age of 86. And as soon as our mother, Hazrat Sarah, comes to realize that our mother is expecting, she felt as any woman would feel in that situation. It was too much for her to handle. It was too much for her to handle. And she said to Ibrahim, O Ibrahim, please, please, take her away from here. Our mother, Hazrat Hajar, fearing uncertainty, not knowing what's going to become of her, when Hazrat When she heard, overheard our mother, Hazrat Sarah, saying this, she ran away. She ran away and began to reside next to a spring, and only returned when Jibra'il, I mean, told her, gave her the glad tidings and told her, "Yo Hajar, you're going to have a son. The name of this child will be Ismail. And you will see much good at the hands of this son and yours." This is when our mother Hazrat Hajar returned. The child is now born. And the name of this child is Ismail. My young friends, Ismail alayhi salam has come into the world. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wished, He could have so easily told Ibrahim, "Kibai, now I want you to sacrifice this child. I want you to slaughter this child with your own hands and offer this child in sacrifice." If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to do this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have so easily do this. But why didn't Allah ask Ibrahim to sacrifice this child when this child came into this world? You know why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted the ultimate sacrifice. Allah wanted the ultimate sacrifice, the greatest sacrifice. Believe me, if Allah ordered Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam there and then to sacrifice his child, and Ibrahim actually sacrificed his child, it would have been a phenomenal sacrifice. It would have been an amazing sacrifice. But my young friends, it would not have been the ultimate sacrifice. It would have been an amazing sacrifice, but it would not have been the ultimate sacrifice. Let me explain. If a child is born to one of you, and let's say, as soon as the child came into the world, a few moments thereafter the child passed away, or a very short time thereafter, this child passed away, Allah took this child died. You would be saddened naturally. You would grieve and you would cry. Because naturally Allah has placed love in the heart of mother and father. Even though at this moment in time, you as a father have not had any time to bond. The mother's been bonding because it's part of her. But because this is a part of you. Now this child was made out of you and your wife. So you will cry and you will be sad. But my young friends, what would this sadness be in comparison to if this child lived and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took this child away after a few years? The difference between the two is the difference between heaven and earth. The difference between two is the difference between the heaven and earth. If the child died immediately, you would be sad and you would cry, but for how long? A few days? A few weeks? And you'd get over it. But you know, if Allah takes away your child at the age of 8, 9, 10, 11. Now there comes baggage. 11 years of muhabbat, of connection, of bonding. Now my young friend, the pain that you will suffer, you can't even count the tears that will flow from your eyes. Let me explain. You know, when a child comes into this world, naturally mother and father are inclined towards this child. And look at the, you know, when a child comes into the world, look at the smile that that child brings on the face of the mother. What's the first thing that she does? She embraces that child. She's overjoyed. 9 months of difficulty. And when the child comes into this world, that was the moment of relief. Look at the joy it brings and the happiness. You know, money can't buy that happiness. You know, those moments that you live at that particular time, you can't put a price to it. It's priceless. This is the initial muhabbat that you have for your child right at the beginning. And then, as every day passes, this love is increasing. And the bond between mother and father and this child is becoming stronger and stronger and stronger. You know, when that child smiles for the first time, You know, you call your child Muhammad, Ahmed, and now he's responding, he's actually smiled when you've called him. You know, that feeling is out of this world. That joy that that child brings at that time, when he's recognized you, is out of this world. When that child begins to crawl, you can't explain that moment. When the child begins to walk, that moment you can't put a price to. When the child calls you for the first time, Abba, Amma, it's better than winning the lottery. Every time this muhabbat is increasing and increasing. When he goes to school, he returns, you're helping him with his homework. On Saturday and Sunday, you're taking him out, you're socializing, you're traveling with him, and you're bonding, and your love for this child is increasing and increasing and increasing. It reaches new peaks and new heights. And when it reaches these new peaks and new heights, and now, let's say at the age of 8, 9 or 10, Allah now takes away his amanat and his trust and the gift that he gave you. It wasn't yours. It belonged to Allah. You have no right to cry or mourn or groan, if you know what I'm referring to, because it was not yours. It was Allah's. But now Allah takes away his gift. You know, for some of us, we end up with depression. We can't handle it. Allah wants this ultimate sacrifice. This is why Allah didn't ask Sayyidina Ibrahim to slaughter and sacrifice this child when he came into the world. And Allah himself paves the way. How does Allah do it? Allah orders Ibrahim, okay, I want you to take this child of yours and his mother and leave him in a place called Makkah. 86 years of age, years of begging and crying. He's just come into the world. He's just got used to kissing him and hugging him and playing with him. This child is still drinking his mother's milk. This is how young this child is. And Allah wants him to separate from Ibrahim. Because you know, when you separate from your child, the rule is, zur ghibban tazdad hubban. When you see people after a period, your love for that person increases. When you see the person all the time, indeed you love that person, but the love doesn't increase as much. When you see that person after a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 5 weeks, the longer you see the person after, the more the love increases. Allah separating the child, and Allah wants this love to burn, to increase. And Allah says, Ibrahim, take Sarah and take this child and leave them in Makkah. Now Makkah, my young friends, wasn't like what Makkah is today. Makkah, in a nutshell, was a barren desert. There was nothing in Makkah. No houses, no trees, no buildings, nothing. No water, nothing. The only thing that you would find in Makkah in those days was burning heat, scorching heat, burning sun, and mountains that have become black because even they can't tolerate the heat. This was the only thing in Makkah. And Allah saying to Ibrahim, take this son of yours with your wife, his mother, and leave him in Makkah. Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam sets off with the journey with Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam from the land of Sham. And every time they came across a green piece of land, pasture, Sayyidina Ibrahim would ask, O Jibreel, is this the place that Allah has ordered me to leave my flesh and blood and my wife? And Jibreel would reply, no. Every time they came across beautiful green land, our Nabi Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam would ask, and Jibreel would respond, no, till they got to Makkatul Mukarramah. Barren desert, nothing, not even a single human being. When they got to the place where the house of Allah is today, Jibreel said, O Ibrahim, this is the place where Allah has ordered you to leave your only child and your wife, Hazrat Hajar. And he leaves them there. He leaves them there with what? One bag of dates and a water bag. This was their entire dunya. One water bag and a few dates. This was their entire dunya. He leaves them there, not hesitant at all to carry out the command of Allah, and he begins to return. And our mother, as a Hajar, says, "Ayna tazhab ya Ibrahim? Oh Ibrahim, where are you going? Oh Ibrahim, where are you going? Are you going to leave us here? In a place where there's nothing, no water, no human beings, no buildings, nothing? And you're just going to walk off like this?" And Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam doesn't respond, doesn't even look back, and continues. She asked again, "Ayna tazhab ya Ibrahim? Oh Ibrahim, where are you going? Oh Ibrahim, are you going to leave us here? There's nothing here." And again Sayyidina Ibrahim doesn't respond. And then our mother asks, "Just tell me one thing. Allahu amaraka bihada? Just tell me this. As your Lord, has Allah told you to do this?" And Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam responds with one word, "Na'am, indeed." And our mother, Hazrat Hajar, responds, "Idhan la yudayyuna." If that's the case, Allah has told you to do this, then that Allah, that Rabb of mine, that Khaliq and Razik of mine, will not let us go to waste. He will take care of our affairs. My young friends, look at the level of Iman and look at the level of tawakkul of Hazrat Hajar. She's not a Nabiya. She's a day-to-day normal woman. The wife of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. Look at the effect. Look at how Hazrat Ibrahim must have worked on Hazrat Hajar for her to give a response which is beyond comprehension. Can you imagine just leaving your wife? You guys live in London here. Let's say you went to Bradford today. And you just left your wife in a house alone, on her own, without even telling her. What do you think she would do to you? I won't even go down there. Can you imagine leaving your wife in a city or town on her own with nothing? What do you think she'd do to you? She'd cut you for bits and sell you at the local butcher's shop. Hundreds of miles from the land of Sham, in a barren desert, not even water, nothing. No human being that she can actually speak to other than her own masoom child, which is still reliant upon her for milk. He leaves her there. Look at the tawakkul and reliance upon Allah. Look at the iman of this woman. The iman of this woman. Look how helpful she was to Ibrahim, for Ibrahim to carry out the command of Allah. How difficult do you think it must have been for Ibrahim to separate from from his child? That he received at the age of 86. And if she started questioning Sayyidina Ibrahim, started making it difficult for Sayyidina Ibrahim, if she started crying, then how difficult do you think it would have been for the Khalil to separate from his wife and child? He continues to walk. And when he gets to a place where she can no longer see him and Ismail can no longer see him, Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam turns to Allah. Turns to Allah, "Rabbana inni askantu min zurriyati biwadin ghayri zizar." Oh Allah, I've left my only child. Oh Allah, I've left my jigar ka tukra. Oh Allah, I've left my wife in this barren land. Khair is izar. Allah, there's nothing here, nothing grows here. There's not even water in the Baytika al-Muharram, next to your sacred house. Why? O Allah, Rabbana liyuqimu salah. So that they establish salah. O Allah, I beg you, fill the heart of some from amongst men with love towards them. Warzukhum min thamarat. And Allah, give them thamarat, give them fruits. La'allahum yashkurun. So that they may be grateful. He prays to Allah, and he leaves his wife and child in the hands of Allah, and now he returns to the blessed land of Sham. How long was that bag of dates and water going to last? How long? A few days, there's not a single day, and there's not even a sip of water. She can't feed the child because there's no milk. She's suffering in this barren desert, and this child is suffering. Crying, tossing, turning on the point of death. Which mother can bear to see her child cry, never mind toss and turn on the point of death? She distanced herself. She can't see it. If he's gonna die, then she doesn't want to witness his death. And she turns away. But at the same time, she's desperate. She wants to save this child, and she climbs Mount Safa and looks. Can she see anything? She shouts. She asks for help. There's nothing there. Her heart is still connected to her child. Is he still alive? So she comes down and runs in the wale and looks at the child. The child is still crying, but he's alive. He's tossing and turning. Again, she can't tolerate. This time she runs in the opposite direction. Maybe she'll see somebody there. She counts Marwa and climbs up Mount Marwa. Looks around, calls, cries. But again, there's no one there. Comes back to see the child, and she does this 7 times. Safa, Marwa, Safa, Marwa, Safa, Marwa, Safa, Marwa. And then to Marwa at the end, Rasulullah said, this is the sa'i that people perform between these two mountains, Safa and Marwa. When she's on Marwa, she can hear a voice. And she addresses the voice, okay, I beg you, reveal yourself. If you can help me, I beg you, help me. And Sayyidina Jibreel appears before her. And with the back of his foot, his heel, and according to some narration, his wing, he strikes the place where the well of Zamzam is today, and water begins to gush out, spring out. And she begins to cleck it and make it a dam. Had she let it be, it would have flowed like a river. She drinks from this, and in turn, she feeds her son Ismail. Now the child is growing. Every day passes, the child is becoming stronger and stronger and stronger. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had made it easy for Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did was, Allah made the earth shrink for him. That's why he was able to cover long distances in a very short time. And he would come from the land of Sham, and he would visit the son of his, and they would meet. He would love him, he would kiss him, embrace him, play with him. He would do as a normal father does with his child. Every day this child is growing and growing, and this bond, as I mentioned earlier, is becoming stronger and stronger and stronger. Now when this child reaches, according to Ibn Abbas, 13 years of age, child is now in a position to look after himself. Is not in need of his mother and father. He can stand on his own feet. Now, after all he went through with regards to this child, now is the time that Allah wants the ultimate sacrifice. Now Allah wants to see whether Ibrahim will do what is asked of him. Allah asks him to sacrifice this child. And Sayyidina Ibrahim saw in a dream, كَيَا بُنَيَّ إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكَ فَانْظُرْ مَا زَتَرَى. He saw that he was offering this child Ismail in sacrifice in a dream, and the dream of a Nabi is wahi, revelation. And as soon as he saw this dream, look at the level of Iman. Without questioning Allah, without thinking for a few seconds, okay, have I understood right or wrong? Without pondering, without deliberating, without making mashwara from his wife Hajar or any other family member, immediately he approaches Sayyidina Ismail and says, O Ismail, إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَهُكَ فَانْظُرْ مَاذَا تَرَى. This is the dream that I saw. I saw that I was offering you in sacrifice. Tell me, مَاذَا تَرَى? What is your opinion? Child is 13 years of age. You were once upon a time 13. What were you thinking of at the age of 13? My young friend, the only thing that interested me and you at that age was the dunya. And play. In this day and age, we can't get enough of these PlayStations and these, you know, PSPs and boxes, this and this. This is a 13-year-old. He's got no worry. The only thing that interests him is the dunya. Here, a 13-year-old child and his father's asking, this is what I've seen, what is your opinion? My young friends, if this child has taught us any lesson, this lesson is called obedience to mother and father. Without hesitation, they say, like father, like son. He's no ordinary child. This wasn't my child or your child. This was Ismail. Sadiq al-Wa'd, Allah says in the Quran. Sadiq al-Wa'd. Like father, like son. As soon as his father asks him, without hesitation, even though he knows this means that he will have to leave this dunya. He will have to leave his mother and father who he loves so dearly. Without hesitation, he said, Ya Aba Tifal ma tu'mar, satajiduni insha'Allah min as-sabirin. Sar an kumpar, O my beloved father, do as Allah has asked you. You will not find me from amongst those that disobey. You will not find me from amongst those that question. You will not find me from amongst those that may even say, "Oof." You will find me from amongst the patient. Do as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered. The day of sacrifice, and Ibrahim is taking this child to the jungles of Mina. And the shaitan appears for the very last time, trying his utmost best to lead this family astray. And he approaches our mother as a Hajar and says, do you know where Ibrahim is taking this son of yours? Yes, he's taking him to gather firewood. No, he isn't. He's taking him to sacrifice. He claims his Allah has told him to do so. And our mother, Hazrat Hajar, look at the level of iman. She said to him, if he claims Allah has told him to do so, then it's best for Ibrahim to listen to his Allah and do what Allah has asked. The shaitan fails. He approaches the son Ismail. Do you know where your father's taking you? To gather firewood. No. He's going to sacrifice you, slaughter you. He claims his Allah has told him to do so. Look at this amazing family. And the child says, if Allah has told him, then it's better for my father to do what Allah has told him. He comes to Ibrahim. Oh Ibrahim, you didn't see Allah in your dream. You saw the shaitan. The shaitan told you to sacrifice your child. Ibrahim realized who this was. He said, Ya Khabis, away from here. And again the shaitan was humiliated and disgraced. Time of sacrifice comes close. And the child says to the father, oh my father, tie me with a belt. Tie me with a belt so I do not shake. Because if I shake, your heart will soften and you'll struggle to carry out the command of Allah. Tie me with a belt so I do not shake and move. And at the same time, keep your clothes away from my blood. Because if your clothes are covered with my blood, when you return, if my mother is to see this, it will sadden my mother. My mother will not be able to bear and tolerate this. So keep your clothes away from my blood. Oh father, make haste in the sacrifice so it is easy upon me. And when you return home, convey my salam to my mother and remind her of the reward of the sabirin. Remind her of the reward of the sabirin so that she accepts this decision of Allah without as much as uttering one word. Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam naturally began to cry. And he said to his son, how helpful you are, my son. Ibrahim is crying. Ismail is crying. The angels in the heaven are crying. And Allah is addressing the angels. Ya malaikati, unzuru ila abdi istahakka al-khulla amla. O my angels, look at this servant of mine. Is he now worthy of being the Khalil? Is he now worthy of my friendship or not? And the angels reply in one voice, Ilahana, لو كنا مكانه لم نصبر. Oh Allah, if we were in the position and place of Ibrahim, then we would not be able to exercise such patience that Ibrahim has exercised. He takes the knife and he passes it over the throat of Ismail. And the knife finds no way as Allah has placed copper there. And the child calls out to the father, oh father, turn me the other way. Maybe your heart softened as a result, there's delay in carrying out the command of Allah. Turn me the other way so you cannot see me. And Allah calls out, enough is enough, O Ibrahim. قَدْ صَدَّقْتُ الرُّؤْيَا إِنَّكَ ذَلِكَ نَزِّلْ مُحْسِنِينَ. You've confirmed the dream. And when he turns around, he saw a lamb from paradise. And he sacrificed his lamb in place of his child. Every single thing, my young friends, about this Nabi was phenomenal. I've already taken enough of your time already. I'm just going to conclude on this note. May Allah give us the tawfiq. These stories are not so that... I've not come here to tell you a story. You already know the story. The objective is to take these lessons that I've mentioned in this story. Look at the level of iman. Look at the reliance upon Allah. Allah is for Allah. Allah is the doer. If Allah wants to protect, there's no one within this universe that can harm. And if Allah wants to harm, there is no one within this universe can benefit. Success lies in carrying out the teachings of Allah and His Rasul. How did Ibrahim become the Khalil? Because of his obedience to Allah. Allah embraced him. Allah made him the Khalil. And if you and I also turn to Allah and carry out these teachings, follow Allah and follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my young friends, just as Allah embraced Sayyidina Ibrahim, Allah will embrace every single one of us. You take one, guys, look at how much we wrong Allah on a daily basis, and even then Allah embraces us. Even then Allah gives us. Even then Allah showers us with mercy. Even then Allah answers our prayers. Can you imagine if you took that step towards Allah and you showed that obedience, my young friends, and that dedication and that commitment and that love? If this is how much Allah is embracing you now, then my young friends, how much do you think Allah will embrace you if you took these steps towards Him with obedience, you followed His teachings, you lived by His teachings? And if this is what Allah will do is for you in the dunya, then what do you think Allah will do for you in the akhirah? If this is how Allah will honor you in the dunya, that you will live like a king in the dunya. And you know, living like a king, my young friends, is not possessing the dunya. Living like a king doesn't mean that you've got 10 houses in London. You know, you're driving a Ferrari or a Bugatti. This is not living like a king. Living like a king, my young friends, is possessing nothing. And even then, you smile by the morning, you smile by the evening, and you smile every day, every night, till you leave this world. This is a king. That is content. That is happy. That doesn't turn to medication. Do you understand? Tablets, because he's suffering from depression. He doesn't commit suicide. He doesn't turn to women and alcohol because he can't handle the pressures of the dunya. That's not a king. How many people out there possess more than what you and I will ever possess? But they're not happy. Why is it that they die of depression? Why is it that they turn to alcohol and dope? When they've got 10 cars, 10 women out there, millions of pounds in their bank balances. Because that, my young friend, doesn't bring about happiness. What brings about happiness? Allah bi dhikrillahi tatma'inna al-qulub. There's only one thing that brings about happiness, and that is the dhikr of Allah, the deen of Allah. The teachings of Allah and His Rasul, and acting upon these teachings. The more you act upon these teachings, the more richer you will feel inside your heart. لَيْسَ الْغِنَىٰ أَنْ كَثْرَةِ الْأَرْضِ وَلَكِنَّ الْغِنَىٰ غِنَىٰ النَّفْسِ. And غِنَىٰ النَّفْسِ, you can't buy it at Harrods or any other place. This you can only buy from Allah. You can only buy in Islam. The more you act upon it, my young friend, even though without a penny in your pocket, this is why you find people living in India or Bangladesh or Pakistan or Africa sleeping on the floor using stones on their pillows. Yet every night when they sleep like kings. There's nothing that affects them. They smile inside by morning and by evening. Allah takes care of all their affairs in the dunya. And if Allah takes care of all their affairs in the dunya, then don't you think Allah will take care of their affairs in the akhirah? everyone striving for the dunya because they're looking for happiness. Yet this dunya may bring about comfort, but it's not necessary that it will bring about happiness. Happiness you can't buy. You can't buy. Happiness is only sold in one shop, and that is the shop of Allah. And I conclude in this note. And that shop never closes. It's available for everyone. It's whether you and I actually want it or not. If Allah doesn't give this understanding, then my young friend, what I've said today is not rocket science. It's very, very simple. You've heard it today, you've heard it before. You'll hear it again tomorrow. But you know, if Allah doesn't give tawfiq, then my young friends, may Allah protect. Allah give me the tawfiq, Allah give you the tawfiq to act upon what I've said. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah alayhi salatullah wa alihi wal ahibba. La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah alayhi salatullah wa alihi wal ahibba.